Thank you to Magic Spoon for sponsoring today's episode. Go to magicspoon.com/scishow and use the code SciShow at checkout to get $5 off any order. We normally look at the climate crisis as something that's harmful to the environment, and while that is definitely true, its effect on plants is not entirely straightforward. Rising carbon dioxide levels can actually be good for some plants because plants use CO2 for photosynthesis. That might mean that when CO2 levels are high, some plants can grow faster. But while that might be a good thing for individual plants, overall, it can actually be a problem. And that's because growing faster isn't always a good thing. Faster growth and higher levels of CO2 can have unpredictable effects, changing the way that plants produce useful or dangerous compounds and potentially throwing off the balance in their environments. CO2 is a relatively small percentage of our atmosphere, making up just 0.04% of its total gases, but it has increased a lot since pre-industrial times. Pre-industrial CO2 levels were about 280 parts per million, while current CO2 levels are hovering between 415 and 420 parts per million. That means that CO2 levels are 1.5 times higher than they were before the Industrial Revolution. Researchers have begun studying the effect of increased CO2 on plants, and some of the results are pretty surprising. For example, some vegetables become less nutritious at higher levels of CO2. Now, exactly why this happens is still unclear, but it does seem like higher CO2 levels might reduce the amount of nutrition that we get from our food. That could have big repercussions for human health, especially in parts of the world that are already dealing with food insecurity. And something similar can happen to tobacco plants, which produce less nicotine at higher levels of CO2. And it would be easy to predict how rising CO2 levels might affect plants if the effect was always the same. Instead, what happens varies from species to species. Plants can also produce more of their active ingredients. One example of this is sweet wormwood, which produces artemisinin, a treatment for malaria. Under high CO2 conditions, wormwood produces more of that compound. And plants like the wild poppy produce even more opium-related chemicals at higher CO2. So we just don't know enough about how plants are going to change moving into the future. But what we do know is that in some cases, higher CO2 levels can even make plants more dangerous. Take, for example, the famine weed. The famine weed is native to Central and South America. In its natural habitat, its growth is controlled by organisms that eat the weed's leaves, like the Parthenium beetle. But outside its native environment, the famine weed is a harmful invader. It's an invasive species in Australia, Africa, and the Indian subcontinent. It's particularly harmful because it produces a toxin called parthenin, which prevents other plants from growing around it. The toxin helps the plant spread by killing competing plants, and possibly also making the plant unappealing to herbivores. Aside from being harmful to surrounding plants, parthenin can also cause asthma and skin irritation in humans, so many of the countries where it's invasive are very interested in controlling its spread. That was the motivation of a 2021 study published in Nature Plants, which looked at the spread of famine weed in Australia. Famine weed was introduced into Australia in the 1950s, but although two biotypes of famine weed were introduced at around the same time, only one biotype flourished and became invasive. A biotype is a group of genetically identical organisms within a species. They're what you might also call a strain, so a single species can have multiple biotypes. The researchers were initially looking into the difference between the two biotypes, trying to understand why one would become invasive while the other did not. And they did find one lead, that the invasive biotype produced more parthenin than the non-invasive biotype. They also discovered that CO2 levels can change the way the plants produce parthenin. When they grew the plants with pre-industrial levels of CO2, the invasive biotype didn't produce as much parthenin as it does in the wild. But ramp up the CO2, and the amount of parthenin produced by the invasive biotype also increased. The non-invasive biotype, on the other hand, didn't increase the amount of parthenin it produced when grown at higher CO2 levels. This means that the invasive biotype has probably adapted to use the current high CO2 in the atmosphere to its advantage, using the increased levels of CO2 as a source of carbon for parthenin production. And so, as CO2 levels increase, the famine weed's invasive biotype could become even more toxic and even more invasive. That's a concern not just for famine weed, but also other toxic plants, which might also take advantage of the extra CO2 to produce more toxins. Many of these toxins help the plants outcompete other plants or protect themselves from predation, and that means that plants that develop stronger toxins could become better at outcompeting other plants. And while this is a problem for invasive species, it could also be a problem for native ecosystems. One plant suddenly adapting to outcompete all the others could be disruptive for the ecosystem as a whole. In fact, It could be that some plants have already begun changing to adapt to high carbon conditions, just like famine weed. The fact that this is happening already is a reminder that fighting the climate crisis requires us to pay attention to what's happening now, not just to try and predict what will happen in the future. It's important to study how rising CO2 levels change the physiology of plants, because it turns out just feeding them more carbon dioxide is not automatically beneficial. It's just one more element of the climate crisis that we need to understand. Thanks to Magic Spoon for sponsoring today's episode of SciShow. I don't know about you, but breakfast cereal for me it's very nostalgic. It's a nostalgic experience. It takes me back to the Saturday morning cartoons. And with Magic Spoon, you can indulge in that nostalgia with flavors like cocoa, fruity, frosted, and peanut butter. But unlike what you probably ate as a kid, Magic Spoon cereals are low in sugar and suitable for all kinds of dietary needs. They're keto-friendly, gluten-free, grain-free, soy-free, and low-carb. Magic Spoon has 0 grams of sugar, 14 grams of protein, and only 4 net grams of carbs in each serving. It's also only 140 calories. If you'd like to try it out, you can go to magicspoon.com/scishow to grab a variety pack and try it today. Be sure to use the promo code SciShow at checkout to get $5 off any order, and if you don't like it for any reason, they will give you your money back, no questions asked.